A very good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. There are no apologies this morning and Fulton McGregor is joining us online. So our first item of business today is to consider whether to take item 6, consideration of today's evidence in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. So the next agenda item is consideration of an affirmative instrument, that is the Draft International Organisations Immunities and Privileges Scotland Amendment Order of 2023. And I'm pleased to welcome the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, Angela Constance, and her officials to the meeting this morning. So Walter Drummond Murray, Head of Civil Courts Unit, Connor Sampson, Justice Cooperation Policy Manager, and Emma Thompson, Solicitor with the Legal Directorate at the Scottish Government. And I refer members to Paper 1. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak to the instrument. Cabinet Secretary.
Good morning, Convener, and thank you. The draft, the International Organisations Immunities and Privileges Scotland Amendment Order 2023 confers various legal immunities and privileges upon the International Criminal Police Organisation, more commonly known as Interpol, and specified categories of people connected to Interpol, so far as this is within the devolved competence of this Parliament. The UK Government has negotiated a privileges and immunities agreement with Interpol in order to provide Interpol with the privileges and immunities necessary for it to function effectively within the UK and to enable Glasgow to host the 2024 Interpol General Assembly, for which granting privileges and immunities is a prerequisite. The agreement regulates the privileges and immunities that are afforded to Interpol, such as certain tax exemptions and immunity under certain conditions from legal process. The agreement obliges the United Kingdom to abide by the terms of the agreement. The order before the committee today fulfils those obligations insofar as they relate to devolved matters in Scotland. Equivalent provision in respect of reserve matters and devolved matters in the rest of the UK is being conferred by legislation at Westminster. However, to the extent that the privileges and immunities relate to devolved matters in Scotland, conferral rightly falls to the Scottish Parliament. When respective parliamentary passage is complete, both orders will go before the Privy Council in July. In order to assist the committee, I will say a little bit more about the nature of the privileges and immunities involved. The immunities cover things done or admitted to be done by members of Interpol only while exercising their official functions in connection with Interpol and the General Assembly. There is an exception to the immunity in respect of road traffic accidents. All persons enjoying privileges and immunities are expected to respect the laws and regulations in force in the UK, and the Secretary General of Interpol must cooperate at all times with the appropriate UK authorities to prevent any abuse of these privileges and immunities. The order also provides for the inviolability of any private residence of the Secretary General, exemption and privileges in respect of personal baggage, and exemption or relief from all devolved and local taxes. It is customary to grant such privileges and immunities to diplomatic missions and international organisations to enable them to function. The agreement is broadly in line with global practice and includes provisions to ensure that immunities and privileges do not impede the proper administration of justice. The privileges and immunities conferred by this draft order are granted primarily on the basis of strict functional need. They are no greater in extent than those required to enable Interpol and specified individuals connected with Interpol to function effectively. This immunity does not apply to a person who is a British citizen or any person who, at the time of taking up his or her functions, is a permanent resident of the United Kingdom. Immunities and privileges are therefore limited in that they apply only to official functions and can be waived. The immunity is analogous but more limited than that which has been for generations conferred upon diplomats working in foreign jurisdictions. As with diplomatic immunity, all individuals benefiting from privileges and immunities in Scotland are expected to respect Scots law, both criminal and civil. To conclude, Convener, the draft order implements the agreement that the UK has reached with Interpol in line with global practice. It enables Interpol to hold the General Assembly in Glasgow and conduct their activities in the UK while ensuring and upholding protections for the effective administration of justice. As a good global citizen, it is the responsibility of the Scottish Government to bring forward this order to the Parliament for consideration, and I commend the order to committee.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. That's very helpful. So we'll just now open it up to questions, and I wonder if I can maybe just kick off just to ask, I think you did cover it in your opening remarks, Cabinet Secretary, but it was just to confirm that the provisions that we're looking at today would be for the duration of the General Assembly event, if you like, only, and don't stretch beyond that. It was just a little bit of part of the policy note that we have speaks to it's necessary to grant Interpol the relevant privileges and immunities required to operate effectively across Great Britain and Northern Ireland on an ongoing basis. So it was just to confirm that that doesn't mean that once this is in place, or if it is agreed today, it would be a permanent provision.
So as my speaking note and the policy memorandum indicate, Convener, that there are two functions of this order. Mm-hmm. One is absolutely to enable Glasgow to host the General Assembly of Interpol. So, you know, there is very specific consideration given to the operational needs of Interpol with respect to those functions. But there is also another purpose to this order, and it's particularly important post-Brexit mm-hmm. to ensure that the United Kingdom can continue to collaborate with Interpol, given the importance of Interpol as an international forum of cooperation in terms of law enforcement. So there is no end date to this order, but of course it is for either party to terminate it, either in terms of Interpol or the United Kingdom. So it's a necessary order, both for the specific function of the General Assembly and for the individuals who will attend that General Assembly, but there is also a broader function in terms of what the UK government have negotiated in terms of the agreement, in terms of securing an ongoing relationship with Interpol. And I would conclude, Convener, that it's in all our interests for the UK to continue to engage with Interpol.
That's very helpful. Thanks for that clarification. Okay, so I've got Jamie Green wishing to come in, and then Russell. Jamie?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and other guests. I had two short questions. The first, to congratulate the City of Glasgow on a successful bid for hosting this event in conjunction with the AFCDO. But my primary question is in relation to comments you made about road traffic accident exemptions. Would that be a blanket exemption to all delegates for the duration of their time in Glasgow? Or could there be, for example, if an incident did occur, could the proposition be made that this occurred while they were exercising their duties, which I think is the language you used, and therefore could claim immunity in certain circumstances? So I was just a bit unclear as to how that would be applicable by Police Scotland if, in the hopefully unfortunate event, which we hope doesn't happen, but if it were to happen, how that would be handled by the police.
So I'm grateful to Mr Green for raising those matters. It is, of course, a great opportunity for the City of Glasgow. This is a prestigious international event. It's not as big as COP26. It will be on a smaller scale and won't last for the same duration. It will have less delegates than visited the City of Glasgow during COP26. But nonetheless, it's a great opportunity for the City to show that it is well able to host such events. And if I just perhaps reread the pivotal sentence in my statement, is there is an exception to immunity in respect of road traffic accidents. So that's an exception to immunity in respect of road traffic accidents. And I think that is very clear. I don't know if officials would wish to add anything to that, but I think that the facts of the matter is there is an exception to immunity.
Okay, thank you. And it is more just in relation to somebody, for example, commuting from their temporary place of residence to the conference centre, for example, and something happened in that environment where they could argue otherwise. Yeah. Okay, that's fine. The other really is a more general question, and that's just what discussions the Scottish or UK government perhaps has had with Police Scotland with regards to policing the event itself, if there's been any analysis on resourcing levels required or even perhaps any finger in the air on perhaps the financial cost of it. Not that that's an issue as such, but it's just important for the committee to keep a watching eye on these things.
Sure, and it will be for the UK government to meet the costs that are incurred by the City of Glasgow and Police Scotland, and the Home Office have been very clear with regards to that. We are still some distance away from the General Assembly. We are looking at November next year, so much of that work will be continuing in terms of, you know, estimating costs. But both Police Scotland and the City of Glasgow are confident that the plans they have in place are appropriate, but there will continue to be very close dialogue between the Scottish Government, UK Government and, of course, our partners in the City of Glasgow.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Russell Finlay.
Thank you and good morning. I'd also like to put on record, I'm very pleased that the United Kingdom Government has secured this prestigious event for Glasgow and have decided to host it in Glasgow. And I agree with the Security Minister, Tom Tugendhat, who says that it underlines the UK's role as a global leader in security and policing. And I'm also grateful to all the members who've supported my parliamentary motion, which I'll just take the opportunity to briefly plug. Now, I was going to ask the same question that Jamie Green asked about the road traffic, and it's an exemption. So my understanding would be taking the high-profile case in which a young man was killed by an overseas diplomat in the UK. Do you know if that exemption has been arrived at due to that particular case?
So it is my understanding that past experience always informs future negotiations over matters in and around these important agreements.
Yeah, OK. And the other thing, I suppose more general, with COP26, is this pretty much the same thing? There's no meaningful difference to the exemptions and...
Yeah, it's broadly similar.
Yeah, OK, great. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other members like to come in? No? OK, thank you very much indeed. So I will now invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion S6M number 08712, that the Criminal Justice Committee recommends that the International Organisations Immunities and Privileges Scotland Amendment Order 2023 be approved.
Moved.
Thank you. So the question is that motion S6M number 08712 in the name of Angela Constance be agreed. Are we all agreed? And I'll just confirm if... Yep, OK, Fulton's indicated his agreement. OK, on that note, I'll thank the Cabinet Secretary and your officials for your time, and I suspend the meeting briefly to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you very much. Thank you very much indeed. So our next item of business is an evidence session on tackling online child abuse, grooming and exploitation. So this is the committee's second evidence session on this issue following our initial consideration back in May last year. So I'm very pleased to welcome to the meeting this morning Daljeet Dagon, Programme Manager at Bernardo Scotland, Stuart Allardyce, Director with Stop It Now Scotland, Lucy Faithful Foundation, Wendy Hart, Deputy Director, Threat Leadership, Child Sexual Abuse with the National Crime Agency, Joanne Smith, Policy and Public Affairs Manager, NSPCC Scotland, Detective Superintendent Martin McLean, Head of the National Child Abuse Investigation Unit, Specialist Crime Division, Police Scotland, and Alison Penman, Senior Manager with Dumfries and Galloway Council and Deputy Chair of the Child Protection Group of Social Work Scotland. So a warm welcome to you all, and I thank you for providing your written evidence, and I refer members to papers 2 and 3. And I intend to allow up to around 90 minutes for this session this morning. So we'll just move straight to questions. And I think perhaps just to kick things off, invite you each, and I'll just go from my left to across to the right, and perhaps just invite you to make some short opening remarks just in and around the work that your respective organisations are undertaking and have been developing in relation to this issue. So if I may, I'll start with you, Daljeet Dagon.
Thanks very much, Convener. I suppose from Bernardo Scotland perspective, we've been working on the issue of child sexual abuse and exploitation for around 30 years in Scotland. Mm-hmm. I personally have been involved with the organisation for over 25 years of that, so substantial experience. And I think from our perspective, I suppose what we'd want to say is that we still don't have an understanding of what the scale and nature and extent of child sexual abuse is in Scotland. And I think that's a critical issue for us to consider. And I think we also now need to be aware of the new and emerging themes and harms that are also relevant. Do you want me to wait until that finishes?
Apologies for the interruption. It's We've just got the windows open because it is quite... quite warm in the committee room. I think we're fine now.
Okay, no worries. And I suppose I think, if again, from a perspective in terms of working with children and young people, we spent too long expecting children to protect themselves and take responsibility for the abuse and harm that they suffer and encounter. And it's about time that we basically made technology organisations and companies take much more responsibility for both preventing abuse from happening in the first place, but also looking at measures that can continue to protect children from harm going forward. Mm-hmm. And I suppose the last thing I would want to mention is that whilst we want to focus on sexual abuse today, I think it's also important to think about the other harms that children are exposed to online, and that in particular from my perspective and our organisation perspective also includes child criminal exploitation in particular as well, which is kind of on the rise in terms of online coercion and abuse as well. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And I'm sure there are some points that you raise in your opening remarks that members will certainly want to come back to. Stuart Allardyce, can I bring you in?
Thank you, Convener. Stop It Now Scotland is part of the Lucy Faithful Foundation, a UK charity that focuses on the prevention of child sexual abuse. We were established in Scotland in 2008. The UK charity goes back to the 1990s. We do a number of different things. So our UK helpline works with several thousands of individuals every year who are worried about their sexual thoughts, feelings and towards children, including people who are involved with online behaviour. And they can use the anonymous and confidential support that is provided by our child protection professionals who staff the helpline. In Scotland, we work with around 100 individuals who have been arrested for online offences, who can't get access to statutory supports until they're convicted. At present, that's taking around 2 years for individuals to be convicted. We also work with partners and family members of those individuals, and we also work with around 30 young people who have been charged with online sexual offences as well every year. So we provide support, challenge, and therapeutic care for those individuals. I think the key things I would want to convey to the committee is that prevention of online harm has three components, one of which is safety by design, the stuff that tech companies need to take on board, which the online safety bill is driving. The right messaging to young people and parents themselves, taking on board Daljeet's point that it's not the responsibility of children to stop themselves being abused, but there are messages that can be helpful for young people in this space. And finally, perpetrator-focused prevention, making sure that deterrence and disruption and early help is provided for individuals in this particular space. All those components need to be in place. It can't just be one that will actually define what prevention looks like. And all of that needs to be locked into a strategic vision with the right kind of resourcing and scalability of solutions. But I'm sure we'll tease that out as we go through this today.
Thank you very much indeed, Stuart. Joanna Smith, I'll come to you now.
So the NSPCC led the campaign for the introduction of legislation to strengthen the regulatory regime around the online environment back in 2018. There's been kind of a number of delays in terms of pushing that forward, a lot to do with kind of political unrest at Westminster. So it's been deeply frustrating not seeing that level of momentum and priority given to children's safety online, given we know the harm that's been done in the intervening years. So I'm really glad that the committee is facilitating this conversation now. We are involved in the development of the legislation at a UK level, but we also see and feel the scale and nature of childhood sexual abuse online through increasing contacts to Childline. And we are hearing, whilst children's experiences are wide and varied, we see a trajectory where unsafe design functions within online spaces are being exploited by perpetrators and putting children at risk. The scale that we're seeing is not inevitable. The prevention is possible. The technology exists now to build in prevention at the design stage, and it's really important that we're pushing ahead and making sure, as Daljeet says, that accountability is felt within the tech industry. We are increasingly upskilling young people to keep themselves online. There's a huge appetite from most parents to upskill themselves to keep their children safe online. The police are doing an excellent job in terms of better detection, moving to prosecution. It's really vital now that the tech industry step up to the plate and take their share of the responsibility to keep children safe when they're using their platforms. And the online safety bill will go some way to do that, hopefully.
Thanks very much, Joanna. Wendy Hart.
Hi, thank you very much for having me here today. So the National Crime Agency is focused on tackling CSA upstream, online and overseas. And when I say that, it means looking at the architecture which supports this kind of criminality, the online space and those other international jurisdictions where criminality takes place. We have an active engagement in terms of understanding the threat through our intelligence collection capabilities and strategic analysis and investigating CSA. But for the purposes of today, we have a system leadership role which is defined in the Crime and Courts Act 2013, which is to secure an efficient and effective response to serious and organised crime, including online child sexual abuse. And to do that, the National Crime Agency works through strategic governance arrangements, of which Police Scotland are key and active members, to work across the four Ps, or as the Scottish SOC strategy is, the four Ds, to engage across prevention through to pursue responsibilities. I would agree with comments from colleagues that the scale is increasing, and it's increasing in complexity and severity, and that prevention performs a critical part of an early intervention. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Now I'll come to you, Detective Superintendent McLean.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the invitation today. Child sexual abuse and exploitation remains a very high operational priority for Police Scotland. The scale is such that we continue to experience enduring increases, and the latest figures for the last financial year show a 6.6% increase on the five-year average of our crimes that are recorded as online child sexual abuse and exploitation. We also continue to see significant increases in the industry referrals, particularly from the National Centre for Missing and Exploited Children, an increase of 500% since 2015 to 2022. These referrals in the main translate into enforcement activity largely carried out by my operational teams, and just by way of illustration, last year alone translated to 712 investigations, 489 arrests, and 782 children safeguarded. Police Scotland's approach, it remains the case that we want to be at the forefront of international good practice. We are utterly committed to robust enforcement and tackling perpetrators, but we totally understand the importance of our partnership working and the preventative approach that's been touched on already by some of our colleagues here today. The multi-agency preventing online child sexual abuse and exploitation meeting, and there's detail on that in the written submission, is a critical facet of this. The work with Horizon EU and the 2PS Prevent and Protect through support, the work with Childlight, and indeed the IPSCAN conference in Edinburgh later this year are all illustrations of our commitment to working in that international sphere. The MOXIE meeting has also been important in our engagement with both originally the Department of Culture, Media and Sport and the Home Office, but also our developing relationship with Ofcom Scotland in anticipation of its increased profile and regulatory role with the Online Safety Bill. There are some more detailed matters in the written submission, but hopefully that's enough to start, Convener.
Thanks very much indeed. And finally, I'll come to yourself, Alison Penman.
Thank you, Convener. From a social work perspective, our child protection responses are similar to how we respond to other areas of harm, although there are some things we would want particular consideration taken into account. Across Social Work Scotland and in partnership, we are in the process of implementing the 2021 National Child Protection Guidance, with full implementation expected by autumn of this year. Within that, there's particular attention paid to interagency referral discussions, or IRDs, and that's where we have police, social work, health and often education at the table making those very initial decisions together in terms of how we respond to children who have been harmed or indeed who are harming towards others. We particularly would like to see in the discussion consideration and recognition of children who behave harmfully towards others, who often require different approaches in terms of intervention programmes, and within that we would want to see links being made to the Care and Justice Bill and the Age of Criminal Responsibility Act, thinking very much about where do children fit into this, particularly in relation to the Bairnshaus development, and how do we ensure that children who harm other children are properly supported to recover from their trauma as well as addressing their offending. We work closely with CYCJ in relation to our frame guidance, so how we implement care and risk management strategies for children who behave dangerously towards others. Ultimately, we would be looking for an overarching strategy which brings all the different kinds of sexual harm that children experience together. So Westminster have obviously, they have a sexual abuse strategy, but within that they barely recognise children who offend against other children or children who behave harmfully towards other children. So there was potentially a missed opportunity there that we wouldn't want to follow down that track. So we would be looking for an overarching sexual harm strategy that looks at prevention, intervention and recovery, and that is properly resourced so that the partners have the facilities that they need and the resources to respond, to recognise, identify, respond and help children recover from their experiences.
Thanks very much. Gosh, a lot just even in the your opening remarks, so lots for us to try and unpick in our questions. So I'm just going to open it up to members. I know there'll be some questions that they'll want to ask, and we'll start off with Russell Finlay.
Yeah, thanks very much. Good morning. I've got a lot of questions, but I'll ask a couple now, and if there's time, perhaps come back in.
If I can maybe just suggest to members, just so that we are using our time as efficiently as we can. If you want to direct your questions to specific panel members.
Absolutely. Okay, so I suppose this one will probably be for Martin McLean. Last year, Bex Smith, your Police Scotland colleague, told the committee there are about significant legislative gaps in relation to child sexual abuse and exploitation. She gave a couple of examples, one being no specific Scottish legislation relating to prohibited images, and the current criteria for an application for a risk of sexual harm order does not cover online offences. Now, what we later discovered, and it's been a year has now passed, is that the former Justice Secretary Keith Brown told the committee that Scottish Government had indeed engaged with the Crown Office over these particular concerns raised by your colleague, and he said to us that in writing that in due the Scottish Government are assessing the Crown's feedback and will meet with Police Scotland in due course to discuss a response to the issues they've raised. So I suppose a year down the line, I'd quite like to know if you've yet had that meeting, if you've yet had that feedback. Do you know what the Crown's position is in response to the requests that were raised by your colleague? Was the Crown's position put in writing? And if so, perhaps we could see that. And really just where we're at.
So, okay. There's a number of questions in there. So if there's written submissions from Crown to Government, then that's not a matter for me to comment on. We have had a meeting with Scottish Government colleagues on the notion of legislative gaps that were raised last year. On the specific point of the risk of sexual harm orders, it's arguably academic now because that has now been replaced by the sexual harm orders, and the previous SOPOs are now sexual harm prevention orders. And the replacement for the ROSHOs, sorry, I think I used it, sexual risk orders, the criteria are much more favourable in terms of being applied for. So that gap, if you like, is no longer relevant, which is helpful.
Now, those two elements seem to have been dealt with, but in the written submission made by Police Scotland for this particular session, you identified four serious issues that relate to indecent images of children, extreme pornographic material of a sort of CGI or cartoon format, childlike sex dolls, and something described by Police Scotland, and I'm not entirely sure what this means, as preparatory acts and collection of relevant information. Yep. And these are still legislative
Those matters
gaps.
Are still extant, so to speak, and there's not been a definitive resolution as to the way forward, but there have been constructive meetings with the Government, and my understanding is the plan for Government colleagues to bring back Police Scotland and Crown to the table to discuss further.
Right. And are you satisfied with the pace of this progress?
There's a detail to be worked through, but yes, I'm not unduly concerned by the pace. But
yeah, okay, thank you very much. I've got a question for Stuart, if that's okay. In your written submission, there's a number of asks of the committee. One of these is the need for a Scotland-wide strategy to tackle online child sexual abuse. There isn't one in Scotland. There is, however, one in England and Wales. How long have your organisation been asking for this, and do you know what stage we're at progress-wise?
Well, we've been asking for this for two or three years now, and I know it's something that other children's charities have also pointed out as being a significant lack. There's a action plan for Wales, and separate from that, a Home Office strategy for tackling child sexual abuse in England, but nothing in Scotland. That's not to say that there's a huge amount of activity going on, both in the general field of tackling child sexual abuse and online harm, and indeed in prevention. But it means that there's no strategic vision, and it means that solutions are often piecemeal and quite disconnected from each other and are not adequately resourced.
Right, okay, thank you. And similarly, one of the asks is the need for a Scottish deterrence campaign. And again, there's a difference between there not being one currently, but similar things are happening elsewhere. Do you know whether that's progressing? Or?
Well, to be frank, we haven't had extended discussions with the Scottish Government about that, but I think we should. The reason being that our UK charity is funded by the Home Office to do specific deterrence work targeting those who are either at risk of online offending or who have started online offending but are unarrested but may be available to kind of seek early help in anonymous and confidential kind of spaces. What we've seen is a really significant increase in the number of people who are using our online platforms for help in England and Wales, and a really significant increase in the number of calls that we're receiving to our helpline in England and Wales. We're seeing a slight increase in Scotland, but not the same kind of increase in Scotland. And the reason for that, I think, mostly is that the deterrence work that is funded by the Home Office does not extend to Scotland, and there is no ring-fenced funding for deterrence and disruption work in Scotland at the moment. We have done work in partnership with Police Scotland, which has shown really significant uplifts in the number of people coming forward and accessing early support and help with respect to this kind of behaviour. But without the right kind of resourcing, then we won't be able to drive people to those forms of early support.
Great. Can I have another one?
Can I maybe come back to you? And we'll let some other members come in. So I think Pauline McNeill, you'd like to...
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. So the last session that we had was very much into, and still I'm interested in, image-based abuse across the board. I've done a bit of work since we had that conversation at the last committee, and I'm now convinced there is a gap in the law in relation to abuse of sex-based images, particularly in relation to consent, because it's about the sharing of those images and the damage and the harm that can be done to children in particular and young people. So I suppose that's the context. So Alison, you mentioned this specifically, so I wanted to ask your view in relation to, I suppose it's young people, how we want to categorise older children. I know everything in the submissions about the importance of how you message to young people, and you wouldn't do it the same way as you would to adults. Now, most of the work does focus on the risk presented by adults, so I'm totally conscious of that. But since we're talking about children, I wondered if you thought there maybe was a gap in the law because of the harm that can be done. Images are shared, and I know there was Stuart had mentioned, and there's a very live issue now about fake images. I'm not convinced the law is adequate at the moment. I just wondered what you thought, Alison, about that.
I think, yes, we would agree with that. And whilst the majority of online sexual abuse and harm continues to be perpetrated by adults, I think, Stuart, you have some figures in relation to the increase of children who are also offending under that legislation. And the investigative and justice responses to those children are similar, they're more similar to the responses to adults in many instances than they are to children. So it's about remembering that when children behave in dangerous or harmful way to others, that is quite often coming from a place of trauma, and that needs a significantly different response to that. So I don't think we are where we should be in terms of understanding what that needs to look like. I think we need to see online sexual abuse and exploitation as part of an overreaching sexual harm strategy, as I said in the beginning. And I don't think there is enough in relation to that. I think in our production, we made reference to how we link in with schools and how we support schools to be having those conversations with children. Schools, already a lot of schools have mentors in violence prevention, MVP mentors, where we have six-year pupils who mentor and support younger children, recognising that from a child development perspective, influence is often greater coming from other young people than it is coming from adults. Mm-hmm. So schools are doing that actively, but schools are struggling to provide those interventions because of their resource shortfalls as well. And what we're seeing increasingly in schools, particularly since COVID, is an increase in children who are displaying communication disorders or traits of communication disorders, whether that's autistic spectrum disorder, where they are sometimes struggling to understand social interactions, what's acceptable behaviour, what's not. and for children understanding what constitutes criminal behaviour and what constitutes behaviour that is normal because their peers are doing it is a real struggle, but particularly more so for those children who might have additional communication needs.
Thank you. Can I follow up on your last sentence? But increasingly seen as normalised. Now, this is borne out by some studies in England, which we don't have in Scotland. I'm interested in the victims, mainly girls, but not always girls, and the harm that can be done to girls because of... I mean, I would imagine you would include this in the, you know, your the broad definition.
Yes.
And the harm, because of course we don't have control over the tech companies that we would like, which is the current controversy around how far the online safety bill goes. So I note what you said about how to deal with young people and how the trauma can be the basis of which, you know, people's behaviour is maybe what it shouldn't be. But we've got this normalising in schools as acceptable. I just wondered if you'd come back at me on that, because that's the area where I think maybe there needs to be stronger messages in the law in relation to sharing of images, because once those images are shared, very difficult to get them back.
That's right. So children often don't know when, because that activity taking place within schools is usually children sharing them with other children. Quite often, children still don't know that they're breaking the law by doing that, and they don't understand the far-reaching consequences of such behaviour if somebody was to complain, if they were investigated, if they were charged. Now, it's likely that would be dealt with through the children's hearing system, but that's still on the record. You're right in terms of the impact. The impact for victims of that kind of behaviour can be life-changing. It can be absolutely life-changing. So that's why we need to be able to look at this thing from that legislative perspective, but also from that identification, recognition, prevention and intervention.
Thank you. I know that Stuart might want to answer that question, but could I ask Deputy Superintendent Martin McLean, if you think, what are the powers that Police Scotland or, in fact, I'm not even sure it's out there, your jurisdiction have to delete? Let's see. Well, the issue is a grey area about whether it's actually contrary to the law, but are there any powers on the deletion of images?
Yeah, so Police Scotland specifically doesn't have any specific power in that regard, but the Internet Watch Foundation tend to take the lead, and there's report and remove tools that so police can refer on behalf of a victim, for example, or indeed victims and their families can report themselves or refer themselves or the image at stake to the likes of the Internet Watch Foundation to then assist with the removal of that image off the internet. Does that answer your question?
That's helpful. I don't have any further questions, but I thought maybe the other panel members, like Stuart Allardyce, might want to just answer the same question.
No, thank you. And I mean, I think your point is very well made. Clearly it's important for children and young people to know that the sharing of self-produced images is illegal. But we need to be cautious here about messaging. And the reason I say that is that we now have a kind of growing body of research which tells us that zero tolerance approaches to young people being involved with self-produced sexual imagery, sharing often images of themselves within consensual contexts initially with peers, that the more that we tell children not to do this, the more difficult it is for young people to come forward if they have worries. The 14-year-old girl who shared a photograph of herself with her boyfriend and then is worried that actually maybe that was a mistake, maybe I should go and speak to an adult about that. But if you consistently had messaging saying at school saying, this is against the law, you'll get into a lot of trouble if you do this, you must never do it, it's very difficult for that young person to come forward. So there's a couple of things that...
Sorry, can I interrupt you? I totally accept that, but I want to be specific. I'm talking about where that scenario, the image is then without the consent shared. So I understand, because I did the early legislation way back, I understand the difficulties in where do you draw the lines. It's where that image is shared. I don't think the law covers it, but I could be wrong. So in that scenario?
I might defer to Martin on that, because I think there is legislation.
The so-called revenge porn offence covers the offence, but as your question then, you know, for example, it's one thing if the former partner of the person who sent the image initially sends it on in a malicious way.
You consent to the image, but you didn't consent to it's the sharing.
Correct.
It's the sharing
aspect
of it.
Obviously, if they put it, there's one thing posting it on the internet that then potentially could be taken down via the processes I've described.
Right.
But if they're simply sharing that with another person on WhatsApp or some other social media platform, it's not. If it's a social media platform, it's arguably on the internet. If it's a private messaging exchange, then it's not on the internet as such. You see what I mean? So I don't know if that's what you're asking, how the victim then regains control of that image. And that's the difficulty. It's almost impossible to do that.
Yeah, yeah.
Short of knowing it's one other person that's been shared. If the former boyfriend shares it with one person, and we can identify that person and recover that device in the phone and get it deleted, that might be the tight set of circumstances that I think would be what you're describing, where we could definitively state it's all been removed, as it were, but it's almost impossible to get to that point. Somebody just said, you know, somebody might share it with 10, 15, 20 people.
And is that unlawful to do that? To share it with somebody else? Of course, yes.
Thank you. The messaging really needs to be about, actually, this is risk-taking behaviour, because you don't know what will happen to your image over a longer period of time. And also, probably the more critical issue here is actually coercion and control within relationships, and young women in particular being forced or pushed into sharing images against their own will. So I think there are a number of things that we need to get in here, but they're probably more about education than they are about legislation.
Brilliant. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bring in Jamie Green.
Thank you. I'll maybe continue on this topic a little bit. I don't know, I'm just listening to us having a conversation about it as middle-aged adults. Is there a sense of naivety, perhaps, in the discussion that actually there's a huge amount of normalisation in this type of behaviour now amongst young people? And I know, speaking to parents, teachers, and, of course, young people themselves, when we do visits to classes and schools, sometimes you engage in these conversations about the realities of life as a young person. I haven't been a young person for a very long time, but I know some of the charitable organisations and other third sector organisations here do work with them on a daily basis. I mean, are we trying to police the unpoliceable? And I'm not talking about the issue of people committing horrific, serious online sexual assault, exploitation and abuse. I'm very interested in this subject of the peer-to-peer world and living as a young person, you know, in some cases, even those in primary school, not teenagers, where this sort of behaviour has become normalised because of technology advancements and the fact you have a mobile phone before you get to P1, when I didn't get one until I was 17. So I think the world has changed hugely over the last decade, and I wonder how realistic we're being about these conversations and our messaging and education, and whether there's a reality check at our level amongst politicians and stakeholders and policing, whether we're taking the right approach with this issue and we're trying to police something which is simply unmanageable, and we should be really thinking differently about how we deal with this issue. I'm just chucking it out there because I'm not meaning to be controversial, but perhaps maybe start with some of the children's charities first.
I don't mean coming
in. So I'm just looking at you.
Jamie, I don't mean coming in. I think you're spot on, because none of this is new behaviour. It's been exacerbated by technology, but it's not new behaviours. And I'd like to think it wasn't that long ago that I was a young person, but actually it is. But I'm thinking back, and I suppose the one thing that I often see when I'm having this conversation with practitioners is around, if you think back, you know, sharing imagery, consensual imagery, do you know what I mean, in a consensual environment, was the norm when I was growing up. The only difference was it was a disposable camera.
Right.
And depending on how much money you had, whether you had the money for Express or a 7-day, you had opportunities to intervene before you went to Boots and got those images before they were shared. Whereas now it's, aye, all right, I'll do it. And then you click that button and then you think,
yeah,
I wish I hadn't done it. We also have numerous young people, and it's interesting how we spoke a lot about girls today, because actually the conversations that we've had with boys is that they're often excluded from these conversations, almost as if it doesn't happen to them, which makes it even harder for them to then actually have those conversations and share what's happening to them. So they do feel underrepresented in some of those conversations. But I think certainly from young people's perspective, it's What we've had people say is it's better to get it over and done with, because actually if you don't consent to it, then you just get pestered again and again and again, and that's worse than actually sharing the image in the first place, because it's over and done with. And I remember when a young person first told me that, I was kind of shocked, thinking, wow, do you know what I mean? But at the same time, I could also understand that constant, you know, almost kind of bullying behaviour to say, do you know what I mean? And it is so much easier just to get it over and done with. And it has become the norm, but these are not new behaviours. Mm. And I think from a young person's perspective, we also need to stop talking about online. It's an integrated world for young people. They do not differentiate between what's happening in the digital world and what's happening in the physical world. It's the one thing. So we need to get our heads around that as well. So the language that we are using, and I think there are gaps, but I think anything, when we're doing anything going forward, we need to think of online as part of that. So any strategy we come up with, you know, so I mean, I commend Martin in terms of chairing the online, the Oxy group that we've got, but I think it's about how we integrate that into the wider world. And there was an earlier conversation about a Scottish Government doing enough. And one of the things I would say from our organisation's perspective is that we often have the same conversation, but with different parts of the directorate. And it's about how do you bring all the directorate together? And that's what we're doing in a couple of weeks' time. So rather than having a conversation just with colleagues around the online safety plan or trafficking or child criminal exploitation or contextual safeguarding, it's about bringing those, you know, kind of governmental people together to say, actually, we're talking about the one thing, but the spaces and places can be different, and how we look at it might be different, but it's the one strategy we need to have rather than individual style working that we've got just now.
Yeah, thank you for that. I mean, that's interesting. Before others come in, I mean, it sort of touched on the point Stuart was using about the language you use and not putting people off where there are actual issues, as opposed to day-to-day behaviour that they don't deem to be inappropriate, for example. And I guess, you know, who's best placed to get that message across? Is it in the classroom from teachers? Is it peer-to-peer? Is it educating parents on how to have very frank and normal conversations about these things without being embarrassed? Given that, as you say, we are in an integrated world where, you know, Snapchatting in the playground to somebody who's 3 metres away is normal behaviour. So, you know, I guess when you're putting together all these wonderful strategies and getting governments to come together and legislate for change to improve things, surely that, you know, grassroots on the ground, talking to young people at the earliest opportunity is the best way to get positive messages across about how to deal with problematic situations. I bet I'll bring Joanne in because you've probably got a lot of experience in this.
Yeah, no, I think you touch on a really critical issue. It's vitally important that we recognise that children are the experts in this space. Now, we increasingly understand the value of co-production in terms of policy development and the participation of children in kind of developing kind of constructive solutions to the problems that they face. And nowhere is that more important and relevant than in the online, in the policing of the online space. So actually bringing children's expertise into the development of regulatory processes is really critically important. They absolutely understand the emerging risks that they're facing. They are on the forefront of the new challenges in a rapidly changing context, and they have to be central to the kind of decision-making process. We are actually supporting an amendment in the Online Safety Bill for the creation of a user advocacy body for children, and that's about just really creating a mechanism to bring that expertise right into the heart of overseeing the implementation of a new regulatory regime, so that children are testing out whether the measures that are being put in place are going to strengthen protections for them or otherwise. So the body would have the similar kind of advocacy powers to something like the Citizens' Rights Bureau, you know, that kind of model. Because what we see is a real gap for children's voices. It's largely absent in the legislation as it's currently drafted. And we feel that it's really critically important that, their experiences are incorporated to make sure that they are informing how this new measures have been rolled out. So I completely agree with that. The user advocacy body is a kind of step in the right direction to make sure that we're swiftly responding to emerging risk and managing risk on an ongoing basis.
Thank you. I'll have, maybe we can go back in later.
Yeah, thanks very much. And I'll bring in Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. My question, my first question, I guess I'll direct to Wendy and possibly Martin. We've spoken about the huge increase in the statistics and figures that you have for recorded online child abuse. Do you have any notion or can you even hazard a guess at the actual level, because you're talking about recorded levels, you know, I know it's a difficult question, but I mean, how much more do you think is actually going on that's not recorded?
That's a difficult question to answer.
Yeah, I understand that.
As you say, there have been increasing numbers of online reports, so the National Centre for Missing and Exploited Children, which Martin referred to, received 316,900 industry reports and referred them to the UK last year. That's a slight increase on the year before. The NCA has estimated that there are likely to be between 550 and 850,000 people in the United Kingdom who pose varying degrees of sexual risk to children, including contact offending and online offending in its various forms. So that is our best estimate at this time of the scale.
Quite a wide range.
It's quite a wide range. It's a difficult topic because it is an estimate. We are working to refine that estimate and to understand the threat better. But we think it is consistent with the numbers that are seen in other Western countries. So we are not different in that. It is simply that we have tried to estimate it using the intelligence that we've got. But it is a large number, yes.
What would you make of, do you think there should be a larger public awareness campaign, you know, directed at this subject? And, you know, is that an ongoing thing? Do we need to increase the amount of public awareness and on the subject, do you think?
There has been an increase in public discussion recently, and events like this are very important to do that. Mm-hmm. I think I would agree with the colleagues and comments previously. There is no real distinction between the online and real world anymore, and as we've just discussed, children don't make this distinction. Mm-hmm. Educating adults around this threat is particularly important, and educating adults and parents and carers how to talk to children about this is particularly critical. Sure. Mm-hmm. We produce, in the National Crime Agency, we have an education section, which is Child Exploitation Online Protection, CEOP, education team. We produce materials which are to be used by parents and carers and teachers on how to talk to children about the online threats. Mm. And because of our unique engagement and understanding of the threat, we're able to respond to emerging threats, such as how do you talk to your child about the dark web and what is it? How do you talk to them about sharing images or what are the risks? And how do you talk to them about keeping themselves safe without putting the onus and on children and victim blaming. Yeah. So it's really, really important to have that education angle. That is only one part of education. And it's certainly never going to be enough for the entire country, although we did see a significant increase in downloads during COVID in particular of that material. So I absolutely agree that education on this and more widely needs to be done, but that has to be done in a multi-agency way. And understanding how government can intervene at different opportunities.
Okay, thank you. Alison, if I could ask you, in your statement you mentioned the Bairnshus, and I'm just wondering if you could maybe expand a bit on how you think that will help in what you're trying to do to support offenders and victims?
I think that's an ongoing discussion that needs to be had in relation to how children who behave harmfully towards others fit into that environment. I don't think we've concluded on that yet.
Okay.
But I think it needs further discussion. I think we need to think about that. If we're going to consider children who behave harmfully towards others as behaving in that way, mm-hmm. which comes from a place of trauma, then they are as entitled to and still need the support of that trauma support and recovery in relation mm-hmm. to their behaviours. And if we want to, if we're talking about a preventative strategy, this is about supporting children now to not become the offenders mm-hmm. of the future. Sure. And that's what we would want to do. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Can I maybe just say one thing in relation to the previous point, which is about the normalisation of mm-hmm. this behaviour?
Yeah.
Because it does make me think, is that what we want for our children? And from a children's rights perspective, is it good enough that children feel unsafe, whether it's online, whether it's in their real world at school? If you were to ask children in school what was the thing that they felt least safe about and that they needed protection from, it is unlikely to be about extra or intrafamilial abusers. It is about each other. They don't feel safe in school. They will say bullying mm-hmm. is the thing that scares them most.
Mm-hmm.
And I suppose for me, I don't think we should normalise that. I think we should be striving for more. And it is about that messaging. It's about, I don't know if people have seen the Vanish advert about a child who has autism, a girl. And it was an advert developed by a company. But there's some messaging around that that brings these things right home. For teachers as well, a lot of our teachers mm-hmm. are maybe a little bit out of their depth and thinking sure. about some of these issues. Mm-hmm. Children know and understand this. So we need to be considering how we can implement strategies that allow children to say, no, this is not good enough, I'm not going to accept this.
Yeah.
How do we support that? And in doing so, you asked about, is it schools, is it peers, is it parents and adults? It's everybody.
Yeah.
It's everybody and it's everything. Yeah.
So you're talking about empowering children, really, to say no and
I think
take control.
From a child's rights-based mm-hmm. yeah. approach, is that mm-hmm. not what we want for our children?
Yeah.
To not accept that they're coerced into sharing images mm-hmm. or that they feel they have to or they have to get it over and done with.
Yeah.
Is that good enough for Scotland's children? I would mm-hmm. say no.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. That's helpful. Just one more question, if that's OK. Stuart, I just wanted to ask you, how do you sort of evaluate your success? I know that's a very sort of bland question, but, you know, from the work that you do, what outcomes, how can you evaluate the outcomes of what you do?
Yeah, so our UK helpline is funded by the Home Office and the Ministry of Justice, and each year, as a condition of funding, we have external evaluation that's provided. And that evaluation has taken different forms, but we've had agencies such as Kantar and Britain Speaks that have been involved with those evaluations. One of the evaluations in particular looked at our work with unarrested offenders, so doing survey work with them, and also doing anonymised interviews with individuals. And the key questions that were asked were, after you engaged with Stop It Now, did you do things differently and did you stop mm-hmm. offending behaviour?
Mm-hmm.
And the majority of cases, that was in fact what people did. People made tangible things, mm-hmm. changes in what they were doing. You know, whether it's talking about their behaviour with a partner, whether it's about putting up particular restrictions on their access to things online, whether it's about making particular lifestyle changes. So we do know that prevention yeah. does make a difference.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, and can you just give us an idea? I may have missed this in your opening statement on the sort of gender balance of the people that you're supporting. What, you know, if you can give us an idea, is it mainly?
So, yeah. In terms of the Scotland team, we work with around 100 online offenders every year. Generally, we would work with maybe one or two women, the remainder are men. So it's almost predominantly a male issue.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, convener.
Okay, thanks very much.
I think Martin McLean wants to come
in. Yes, of course.
Sorry, I was just going to come in on that. There was a totality of the threat report done by the NCA, actually, and it was wider than just online child sexual abuse and offending. But I mean, largely speaking, you're talking about 80% male perpetrators and 80% female victims. So it's heavily gendered sexual abuse and crime.
Yeah. Exactly, yeah.
I mean, interestingly, a subset within that of indecent images of children, and the point that Daljeet made, there's an increased level of male victims than the wider subset, if you see what I mean, mm-hmm. Which is an interesting facet. But yeah.
Mm-hmm. OK, thank you. That's interesting. Thank you. Okay.
Still got a couple of members wanting to come in, but I wonder if I can maybe just pick up on this discussion and raise the issue of data. So thinking about, and this is an issue that we talk about quite a lot in the committee, in terms of if we're moving forward and trying to underpin work in and around whatever it might be, tackling gender-based violence, or in this case, tackling the sort of online space. What I'm interested to kind of understand what your views are about what data should we be collecting? How do we do that when there are a lot of moving parts? Different organisations have different roles and responsibilities within the overall work that's being done. So I'm just trying to think about what, as a committee, is helpful for us to understand in terms of developing that underpinning data set. So I'll maybe come to maybe Wendy and Martin first, and then I'll maybe come to Stuart after that. So maybe Wendy.
Thank you. The recent HMIC FRS inspection of online CSA, which applied to England and Wales, highlighted the challenge of better management information and data, mm-hmm. which I think is precisely your question. We are working with policing colleagues throughout the country, and particularly with Ian Critchley, who is the national policing lead in England and Wales, to understand how we better collect data from law enforcement. That is absolutely mm-hmm. one aspect of this. There is some journey to go because of different data systems, different legacy systems, and different recording of crime mm-hmm. Across the United Kingdom. So that's definitely something that we do need to work on, and we're working with Scottish partners on that, part of that conversation. In terms of the future and looking forward, the National Crime Agency will have a role under the Online Safety Bill as a designated reporting body mm-hmm. for CSA content that is either that has a UK locus. That will give us a much better understanding of the UK nature of the threat and will hopefully inform a better strategic assessment of totality. Ofcom, of course, will have their own information gathering powers and their own ability to ask companies what is required. But that will certainly be an important step forward for us to be able to understand in more detail CSA reporting in the UK.
Yep. Thanks. I suppose, I mean, I'm just thinking about, you know, we've got an escalating sort of issue and challenge, so we need to be thinking about how to sort of direct resources in and around that. So, Martin, I'll maybe come to you.
I mean, I've got quite a lot of stats here in front of me, which I think sometimes, and I have to stop myself at times from becoming so immersed in them and trying to keep an eye on what the bigger picture is. And some of the points just we talked about, indecent imagery, for example, and you know, within that basket of online child sexual abuse crimes that I mentioned at the beginning, that's up 6.6 on the five-year average, the indecent imagery is up 18% on the five-year average. So it's a much more significant increase. But, you know, within the enforcement activity that I also described, we keep a weathered eye on how many perpetrators are existing registered sex offenders or archived registered sex offenders, which tends to be about the 10 to 12% feature. How many of the offenders that we arrest are children under the age of 18, which is about 14% of that, you know, 489 arrests. So we do have quite a lot of data that we work with to try and help inform what we do. We take on board feedback. We've had instances of younger people being arrested that Stuart's team had been spoken to, or people had called Stuart's team, and young people being liberated either with an undertaking to appear at court, for example, late on a Friday, or indeed there was a public holiday weekend, there was a Saturday court. Mm-hmm. So we've undertaken to take enforcement earlier in the week so they're not stepping out on a Saturday when there's a lack of services round about them in a way that otherwise might be the case. So there's lots of facets to the data that you can look at. And, you know, suicide, both in perpetrators and victim-wise, is another thing we keep a weathered eye on. We're not seeing significant trends in either aspect of that. We do see quite regular suicides of perpetrators at various trigger points in their journey post-arrest. It can be very immediate. Sometimes it can be quite a bit down the line with court dates, etc., or the anticipation of appearing at court. So we do monitor that as well. And we've done some work with Stuart to try and do what we can to help mitigate that wherever possible. So that's all a wee bit scattergun, I suppose. It just shows you the kind of stuff that we do try and keep an eye on, but that there is so much and so many facets to it. Yeah. Can I just first, there was a couple of points just to pick up on, and Jamie Green had mentioned it, and Alison did too. I scribbled down, it's everybody's job to keep children safe. Teachers, parents, absolutely got a role, but of course we all have a professional responsibility as well. And the notion, I think maybe Pauline McNeill mentioned it about, I think the child protection system and the IRD process, which is a cornerstone of our system, is very good at assessing risk and making pragmatic decisions and not rushing to criminalise young people unnecessarily. It was just to give the committee some reassurance about that, certainly from a police perspective. And then the point that Daljeet makes about online and offline, we've talked about that quite a number of times at the Moxie meeting, and it's just young people just live their lives. Yeah. They don't think about it in online and offline. And also I get vexed about the notion of a hierarchy between contact offending and online offending, because the intensity and invasion of privacy into somebody's bedroom and inescapability at times of the online criminality is really quite significant. And I sometimes refer to in-person offending. If you're being abused live stream-wise, I mean, it's near as damn it in-person offending. It might not be physically in the room, but it's not, you know, it's there's some really, really horrific offending and abuse that takes place, particularly through live streaming. Yeah. That you know, to try and create this hierarchy between contact offending and non-contact or online is unhelpful.
Yes, gosh, thanks very much. And that brings in a whole discussion about how we resource this. But I'll come to Stuart just to come back to your thoughts on how do we make our collection of data as sort of robust and targeted as possible.
I mean, as other people have said, this is a complex problem, mm-hmm. and you need a kind of multidimensional kind of view of what a data set would and should look like. And indeed, some work of that nature is done in Scotland. We provide data directly to Martin and his team with respect to kind of the development of a Scottish threat assessment. What I would say is it's perhaps best to think about this issue as an iceberg, that recorded online sexual crime is just the tip of the iceberg, as NCA colleagues have pointed out. I mean, the threat assessment is massive here. And in fact, if you look at population-based studies that have asked questions about people's online behaviour, most of the population-based studies tell us that between kind of 1 and 2% of males have looked at illegal images of children. 1 or 2%. These are shocking statistics. So what you need to do is clearly map things in terms of recorded sexual crime and reports that are coming from tech companies, the NCMEC data that was being talked about early on. But some of the stuff that we passed to Martin, for instance, we know that there were 12,000 individuals who used our online platforms in Scotland because they were worried about their online sexual behaviour. And we can provide some granular data in relation to where they are geographically, not a lot more than that. But that, the reason why that's important, just to quickly throw this in here, I think there's sometimes an assumption that those who are involved with online offending are motivated, paedophilic, kind of serial offenders. Working with people who commit offences day in and day out, we understand the different kinds of pathways into this behaviour. And actually, there are pathways. It's generally a kind of shifting towards more and more transgressive and indeed illegal material over time by individuals who are often viewing large amounts of legal pornography initially and then shifting towards more illegal materials. Now, if we think about it as a process, going back to points that were made early on, there's enormous scope for public awareness campaigning here. Because if you're worried about your own behaviour, you can do something about that. Which is why actually the data about people who are help-seeking in some way needs to be figured in any kind of data set that exists in relation to this particular problem.
Yeah, Yes, thanks, Stuart. A lot in there. Okay, I'm going to bring in Russell and then Colette Stevenson. Russell.
Thanks very much. Just quickly, in respect of data, the Social Work Scotland submission talks about Scottish Government statistics of child protection register data. And right now, that does not cover or does not give specific data in relation to online harm and abuse or grooming. Is that something that's in discussion with Scottish Government to amend that or to include that in some way?
Not in discussion at the moment. It perhaps is something to think about. I think probably what we know is that in relation to all forms of sexual abuse and sexual harm, there is probably underreporting and not always the recognition of it. So it does not always come through the child protection processes in the way that it should. So that's something that's recognised at a national level in relation to a learning and development programme for social work staff, is that training in relation to sexual abuse is a priority across Scotland. And sometimes that's about thinking the unthinkable. Where people find, particularly if harm is taking place within a family, even if that's within an extended family, and particularly more so if that family happens to come from a professional or a middle-class background, it is quite difficult for people to acknowledge and to think about the horrors that are sexual abuse and sexual harm to children. So there's a psychological approach to that. So it is a priority in terms of training and learning and development. I think there could be further work done to look at that. I think that's something we can take away.
Thank you. The Social Work Scotland submission also had some very interesting stuff about the development of child giving evidence out with a court environment, so the development of the Scottish child interview model.
Yes.
Which, I note that the project team was first set up in 2017, so it's been 6 years of work, yep, almost. And it goes on to say that these are being implemented, yeah, across all areas in Scotland. But do you have any more detail about when and, yeah, what stage it's at and, yeah, whether it's universal? And
I do, although Martin might be better placed to respond because he chairs the National Governance Group. Right. It's interesting, when you were speaking before Martin, I thought I really should have spoken about Scottish Child Interview Model in my opening speech.
Well,
but there is amazing progress being made in, yeah, relation to the implementation across Scotland. Martin, do you want to, as the chair of the National Group?
Thanks, Alison. So I co-chair the National Joint Investigative Interviewing Governance Group alongside a COSLA colleague. Funnily enough, there was a meeting yesterday, in fact, but the current position, to answer your question, so you're right, the project team was set up in 2017. The first 2 years of that work was developing the new training course. And just to very quickly put that in some context, you're talking about a course that previously was a 5-day training course for police and social workers to effect a joint investigative interview of a child in a child protection context. That is now effectively almost a 6-month training programme comprising 5 modules with the best part of 5 weeks face-to-face training and both pre-read and post-modular work to be completed by the students. So the course itself represents a significant enhancement in our investment in how we interview amongst the most vulnerable witnesses and victims in society. So since late 2019 through to date, there's been a succession of initial cohorts trained for various local authority and policing partnerships around the country. We are now 10 policing divisions, 22 local authorities, and it's either 9 or 10 health boards, forgive me off the top of my head for not quite having that. And so we're probably about 80% of the way there, with the initial funding for that team due to expire March 24. So some of those areas are smaller than others, naturally, and some are managing to effect near 100% of their joint investigative interviews of children using the new SCIM model. Other areas are much bigger and have only been able to access one cohort of trained individuals and are working towards full installation of the SCIM model.
So just to understand the stats, the remaining 20% will be part of that funding as well?
Yes, by the conclusion of springtime 24, there'll be SCIM trained officers in all local authority and police divisions of Scotland.
And that'll be policing, but then there's additional in respect of health boards and social work?
Yeah, so health are involved in the IRD process, which is critical to the commissioning of a joint investigative interview, hence them being referred to, but it's only police officers and social workers that attend the training and that effect the interviews.
Right, OK, thank you. There's another thing that's quite interesting in respect of child protection statistics. In Scotland, there's 22 children per 100,000 in the Child Protection Register, but the data elsewhere in the UK is significantly higher. So England's 43, Northern Ireland 45, Wales 52. And I don't quite know what to make of these figures. I don't know whether that means there's a overly cautious approach elsewhere and children are being added on grounds that they wouldn't be added in Scotland, or whether Scotland perhaps sometimes isn't adding children where they arguably should. It's such a stark difference. I just wonder whether, I don't quite know whether that would be for NSPCC or Barnardos or Social Work Scotland, but...
Okay, it's really difficult when you look at statistics around child protection registration, because it's difficult to understand what they mean, and they mean different things to different people. And to be very clear, child protection registration doesn't on its own protect children. It's the professionals and the family that are around the child and planning around the child that offer that protection. Interestingly, I think you'll be aware, England did away with their child protection register, and they now refer to children who are subject to child protection plans, but they don't actually have a child protection register. What you will see, that's an average, you'll see huge variations around the country at any given time, and that can be because of a number of different factors. If there has been a very publicised significant case review or child death review, you will automatically see an increase in child protection registration statistics around that. We spent quite a lot of time examining our child protection registration statistics during COVID, because it was interesting to see what was happening. Were more children at risk? Were less children at risk? Did we know children were at risk? And for any of you that have read some of the absolutely horrendous child death review, or there have been convictions, particularly in England and Wales of late, all of which happened during COVID. So there were some increases in child protection registration during COVID. So it can be variable. It can also vary across the different local authorities in Scotland, particularly in relation to rural areas as opposed to urban areas.
Yeah. I mean, there was a case in 2014 in which a baby died in West Lothian, baby J. I've raised this on a few occasions, and this child, social workers and the nurse attempted to put this child on the child protection register, and others decided that the child shouldn't be.
Yeah.
And it's still not clear as to what went wrong and why that happened. But I suppose that illustrates the point you're making, which is, with or without registration.
Interestingly as well, Scottish Government removed categories of registration a few years ago. So we do still gather statistics in relation to the type of harm that children are experiencing. But what's difficult about that is there are a number of different risk indicators, and it's whether you measure that in relation to the type of harm the child is experiencing or the type of behaviours that adults around the child are exhibiting that are causing the child to experience harm, which means that even our statistics, when we look at them, are not easily explainable, because people are measuring things differently and putting different interpretations on the information around registration.
Yeah.
The national guidance from 2020-2021 should have clarified some of those points, and it did take on board learning from a number of significant case reviews to try and make it as straightforward as it is. But again, I think the interagency referral decision, I think we should be proud of that in Scotland. It's a very robust model. It means we're getting information from all relevant parties immediately, same day the concern comes in. We're making sense of that. And there is a national group that is in the process of developing training. Police have always had that training in relation to IRDs, but bringing social workers and education colleagues on board. And a lot of that is about the analysis of risk. How do we make sense of risk? How do we understand it in terms of the impact of the harm in a way that allows us to predict the possibility of that harm happening again? So there is a lot of work nationally through the implementation of the national CP guidance.
That's helpful. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah, could I come in, Chair? Thank you. Just a couple of quick points to add. and probably Alison's opened the door already, but the decision-making IRD, an effective IRD with effective decision-making, risk assessment and safety planning can almost prevent a child having to go on the registry, the child protection register by the time the what used to be a child protection case conference, now a child planning meeting, comes round. So actually, sometimes I think that gets lost in the mix, that you know, looking at the CPR figures alone is a bit binary, forgive me. Yeah. And then in terms of England and Wales, we've championed our work, both in terms of SCIM and in terms of IRD, through the National Police Chief Council Child Protection Abuse Investigation Working Group, clumsy title that I sit on and represent Scotland. And we've had a number of people come north from the Metropolitan Police, PSNI, to look at our processes, and in particular on back of some of the National Safeguarding Panel reviews into the deaths and murders of Arthur Labino Hughes and Star Hobson, where some of the recommendations that came from that, I remember kind of ticking them off, thinking that's IRD. IRD should, if it works well. So I understand what you're saying about the comparative figures, but the wider systems need to be put into the context of that comparison, and I think we're in a healthy place.
That makes sense. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks very much. So I'll bring in Colette and then Jamie.
Thanks, Convener. One of the in several of your submissions, you've mentioned indirect victims, and I was wondering if I could ask Stuart, because within your submission, Stuart, you say better outcomes need promoted for indirect victims. Could you maybe just elaborate on that and explain what an indirect victim is?
Yeah, so we work with partners and family members of those who have been arrested for online offences. Of the individuals we work with every year who have been arrested for an online offence, probably about half of those we work with are in relationships and have a partner, and a significant proportion also have dependent children themselves. Usually the partner is completely unaware of their husband or boyfriend's behaviour. And the first time they know of the offending behaviour is when the police arrive, quite rightly, often in large numbers, because there is a forensic investigation of devices in the house at the time, but you know, we're talking about 4, 5, 6 police officers that can arrive, often early in the morning, to make sure that everyone's in the household. Obviously, this can be incredibly distressing for partners, for children affected within those families, and indeed for other family members. Let's remember that when somebody is arrested for an online offence, they are likely to have a mother and a father. They're likely to have brothers and sisters. They're likely to have, you know, colleagues and friendships within the community. So those who are indirectly affected, particularly those who are very close to a loved one who's been arrested, will often experience social stigmatisation, will often experience lots of guilt and shame themselves. And indeed, the piece of research that we published last year suggested that in a survey of 120 partners of online offenders, around 60% described some kind of symptoms relating to post-traumatic stress disorders. So significant support needs. We do have a group that we're facilitating with Police Scotland and Social Work Scotland, looking at improving better outcomes for family members affected by this. That group's been running for about 6 months now, but I think where that group will inevitably go is there will need to be some recommendations made about kind of proper resourcing of supports for family members in this space.
Okay, thanks very much. It's interesting actually, because we, it sort of touches upon, we were at an event last night that was hosted by Rona, and it was Families Outside, and there was several, a panel there actually touching upon the impact it has when a person is imprisoned and the stigma and even the cost involved in that as well. And they've done a fantastic report on paying the price. I'm just wondering, Stuart, you know, I'm doing a bit of networking here, if you've worked with families outside or if it's something that you could maybe link in with.
We've been working with families outside for about 8 or 9 years now, right. Partly because when they were running their helpline, they were receiving calls from family members in relation to individuals who had been arrested for sexual offences. At times, the helpline staff felt unequipped to be able to respond to those kind of issues with high levels of shame and stigmatisation. So we've continued to provide support to families outside for several years.
Well, that's good to know. Thank you. The other question is on the actual online safety bill. And it's about, obviously, the bills are seeking to make social media companies, you know, legally responsible for keeping children and our young people safe as well online. But do any of you have any views on whether, is this actually going to be feasible? What's that going to look like? And do you think as well that the bill is actually robust enough to achieve those aims? And, you know, is there maybe significant amendments required as well? And I'll maybe ask Wendy, first of all.
Thank you. I won't comment on the substance of the bill as it's going through Parliament right now, but in terms of feasibility, there are obviously very specific requests and requirements for the National Crime Agency. We are working very closely with Ofcom to understand how Ofcom will seek to fulfil its responsibilities and duties under the bill, including the publication of codes of conduct, which will guide social media companies and other companies in scope of the bill on how they are to fulfil their responsibilities. And we are working very closely with the Home Office and Ofcom to understand the scope of the designated reporting body, as I mentioned earlier, which is the specific requirement that the National Crime Agency will fulfil. We are working hard to meet the deadlines. If the bill comes into force relatively soon, we're working very hard to meet the deadlines for that. It is not a small undertaking to create an online reporting centre, but we are being supported by the Home Office in terms of funding to take that forward. I think that's probably all I can say right now. It is hard because the scope of the bill is not yet set and there's potential scope for change. So we have to factor that into our design.
Okay, thanks. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in on that.
I would come in just on the point about making sure that it's got teeth, essentially. Mm-hmm. And it is massively complex, and inevitably it means that kind of accountability is everybody's responsibility and none. So I think that there are measures in it that could provide that kind of strengthened accountability mechanism, and we are supporting the amendment around the introduction of a senior manager liability. And that is proven to be a successful a tool to drive kind of culture change and behaviour change by making senior managers accountable for failure to take appropriate steps to keep children safe online. Now, the amendment as introduced would make managers accountable where there is evidence that they have failed to take steps to prevent children seeing harmful content, but we would argue that it doesn't go far enough because there isn't that same accountability embedded within the proposals as currently drafted for the more pervasive stuff around grooming and sharing of images and breadcrumbing and those types of events. So that has the potential to be a really kind of robust tool. We see where senior liability was introduced in construction, for example. You know, numbers of deaths and serious harm drop dramatically as soon as people have responsibility and that the buck stops with them in terms of making sure protection's put in place. So it is an effective tool, but as it's currently drafted, it doesn't go far enough, and we'd like to see it strengthened to cover the suite of risk to children so that we can be confident that it's an appropriate vehicle for driving the culture change we need to see across the tech sector.
So just on that, I'm just thinking, like, you know, you've got TikTok that's, you know, hosted by China, effectively. So when you're saying, like, a senior management liability amendment or clause put in, how do you actually apply that? if it's TikTok, say it's TikTok, how do you apply that when it's in another legislature in another country? I'm just wondering how, I don't know if Wendy wants to come back in there on that. How feasible is that, really? And I know you didn't really want to touch upon the bill because it's still going through, but, you know, I think these are questions that everybody needs to hear.
No, it's an important issue. Sorry. TikTok do have offices in the UK, so I think it is yet to be determined at what point that senior management liability kicks in, and I think that we would seek for, I think, more discussions from the Home Office to understand the nature of that particular liability. I think that's all I'll say right now.
Okay. The other thing I just wanted to ask is, do you work and sort of collaborate with sort of the like TikTok, Facebook currently? Do you collaborate with them, you know, with each of your organisations? I don't know if you want to come in on that, Stuart.
Yeah, our UK charity has worked with a number of online platforms. Probably the first was actually Google, about 7 or 8 years ago, where we worked with Google to develop warning splash pages, meaning that if you put in particular search terms into Google, which are suggestive that you're looking for illegal imagery involving children, then you'll get a splash page coming up saying it looks like you're looking for illegal images of children. If you have something that you want to report in terms of an image, then here are the details about the Internet Watch Foundation. If you're worried about your own online behaviour, then you should contact Stop It Now, and here's how you do that. So we've been running those splash pages for some time. We've also worked with Facebook in relation to these. We have had some discussions with TikTok. Rather bizarrely, some of the online platforms who have been most proactive and wanted to work with ourselves have been adult entertainment platforms. So MindGeek, which is the owner of Pornhub, we've worked with for the last 2 years, both developing warning pages with them, but also then with the Internet Watch Foundation launching a chatbot, which approaches people online who are looking for illegal material on Pornhub and some of the other platforms. So we have seen, I think, an openness in the part of tech companies to work with child protection charities such as ourselves. And indeed, we're doing a project at the moment trying to scale up some of the work that we're doing around warning pages. But it would be safe to say that there's still an enormous distance to go here.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in on that. No.
I had a similar kind of relationship with some of the companies that Stuart's mentioned. But interestingly, the ones that we struggle to engage with are Twitter and Snapchat. They're the two who don't come to the table and talk. So I think, like Wendy and others have said, people are working incredibly hard, and we still are working with hope that we will get over the line, and we've got cross-party support for some of our amendments as well. So I still think there is time, but it's getting extremely hard, I suppose, when you've got some key partners who are refusing to come round the table and talk to you.
Okay, no, thanks for that. It's really interesting, actually. So I've got no further questions. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Before, I'm going to bring in Jamie just finally, but before I do that, I wonder if I can just come back to Colette's early questioning just around the impact on victims' families. And I'd be interested, Daljeet, just to hear a little bit about the work of Bernardo's around supporting children, whether they are obviously victims or whether they, I think, as Alison mentioned in your opening remarks about becoming perpetrators, for want of a better word, in their own right. What are you seeing within Bernardo's in and around that?
Certainly what we have done is we've certainly spent quite a bit of time, particularly with our Centre of Expertise, which is based down in England and Wales and funded by the Home Office, spent quite a bit of time on trying to understand scale and nature, trying to understand what the barriers are for practitioners to have conversations, because our practitioners often see a lot of the signs, a lot of the indicators that give them cause for harm, give them cause for concern, but we seem unable to take the next step and have that conversation. So we've been doing quite a lot of work around building practitioners' confidence and resilience around signs and indicators, but also communicating with children, because again, reinforcing the point that it's not children's responsibility to say, do you know what, guess what, guys, this is what's happening to me. It's about us being able to identify from behaviours and not just conversations. Do you know what I mean? Because it's so we've spent quite a bit of time trying to upskill practitioners around how we can have those conversations, because sexual abuse more broadly is something that we struggle with, never mind thinking about it from an online perspective. It's not something that we've been very good at, you know, and even going back to, you know, earlier conversations about child protection registrations, and I take all everything that people have said in terms of that caveat about how we record and sometimes why children might not be registered because other measures have been put in place. But we've also tracked the kind of last 10 years of registrations in Scotland, and our registrations for child sexual abuse have not changed. It was 9% in 2012 and it's 8% in 2022. So, but however, our registrations for emotional abuse, for instance, have rocketed. So it's thinking about those connections, and I think it's about how we try and build workers' confidence to ask questions about what else might be happening other than what they're kind of initially responding to. But certainly in terms of impact, we've also, alongside the Lucy Faithful Foundation, also produced a kind of resource recently about, around looking at a whole safeguarding response to online behaviours and taking into account, you know, the impact on those who have had no knowledge of what's been happening, because even when, you know, as Stuart described, the knock, when, you know, multiple police officers come to a house, you know, and taking devices away, what people need to understand is that includes the smart TV, it includes all the devices that belong to the children and young people as well. It's not just about the devices that are that the offender has sole and exclusive use of. So it has a huge significant impact just in terms of how, because the other thing that we've not really talked about is people get a lot of support from online as well. Do you know what I mean? So if we're taking that support network away as well, that has a huge impact. So I think it's about how we build the kind of resilience of workers to be able to feel confident about having conversations, so that so we are proactive about it rather than waiting for children. And I think also I think it was Joanne who made reference to the fact that children will talk to other children and other young people. So it's about how we build the resilience of other young people to be able to have the confidence to kind of share concerns and worries. And so we spend a lot of time just, I suppose, building up that network of support around children and recognising that can be a number of people. So not necessarily about targeting, but thinking a kind of holistic approach.
Thanks. There's a lot in there, and I think maybe some of our other panel members would like to come in, Alison, I think, just briefly.
I think from a Social Work Scotland perspective, we totally appreciate that exactly what you're saying in terms of encouraging children to talk, to dig a little deeper, to look beyond the presenting concerns. That is relational practice, and I think when I was here last time I said that's absolutely what we should all be striving for. But you will find both teachers and social workers really struggling to have the time to build those relationships, to get down underneath. Social Work Scotland produced the Setting the Bar and Taking the Peel report that identifies that actually to have those meaningful relationships, which would then allow you to have those meaningful conversations, social workers should have no more than 15 children on their caseload. That's not happening anywhere in Scotland. Mm-hmm. Currently, likewise for teachers, if you were to ask teachers how much pupil support time was calendared into their schedule, it's very, very little. So the main point about that is you want to be able to respond when a child is ready to speak to you, but our environments don't always support that because of the resources that are not in place. It's about building those relationships of trust. Building those relationships take time, And unfortunately, that also requires the resources mm-hmm. that we don't have sufficiently currently.
Mm-hmm. But I think if you ask children what would be the difference, and what children tell us is what makes a difference is when someone notices and asks the question. So you don't necessarily need to have a long-term relationship for that. And I think it's about social workers and teachers and having the confidence to reach out to other partner agencies who are able to offer some of that support as well, and working in partnership, as people have mentioned, and in collaboration is really important. So it's recognising and understanding each other's roles within that and trying to prevent... And I know the SCIM model is very much part of it, but trying to prevent children having to tell their story multiple times to different people.
Thanks very much. Gosh, a lot to think about. I'm just going to finally bring in Jamie. I think maybe Martin, you want to come in at some point, but I'll let Jamie come in with his question.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, there's so much that we could talk about and not enough time. So I think what I'll do is I'll just chuck my questions out then. If you want to answer it, just grab my attention. That way not everyone has to respond. But one very specific one is if anyone on the panel had a view as to what role could or should AI have in the blocking or sharing or forwarding of intimate imagery where the sender or receiver is known to be a young person on any platform. It's a very specific question, which would, I presume, require legislation of some sort to get involved at UK or Scottish level. The other question is around what the view is on what is perceived to be an increased exposure among some people to pornography or sexual imagery, and the fact that it is so much easier now to self-generate content on platforms such, for example, as OnlyFans. There are others, not to be specific and pick any out, where it is very immediately possible and accessible to very quickly monetize content of a sexual or intimate nature with a view to either make money or to increase one's popularity amongst peers in a society where being an influencer apparently is a career these days. And I just wondered if there's been a massive shift in the perception of young people around this type of content. And it probably links in a little bit to my earlier line of questioning as well. So just wave your hand if you want to talk about any of those very specific issues. I'll start with Stuart.
To take that second point first, it's a good point, Jamie. And we're certainly aware of, 16 and 17-year-olds who have been involved with OnlyFans, and indeed that stuff around, the commercial kind of economy that's generated by these kind of platforms then being a driver in terms of exploiting kind of young people in all of this. But we're a child protection charity, so we don't pay an awful lot of attention to what happens to people after the age of 18. But I think there's maybe a bigger issue sitting underneath what you're saying, which is the pornification of society and indeed children more generally. Mm-hmm. So the key documents on this are the reports from the Children's Commissioner in England and Wales that have come out there this year, which have shown that, in terms of young people being exposed to pornography for the first time, on average that's taking place at age 13, but we have children at age 11 and 12 who are being exposed to such materials in fairly large quantities as well. So by the time those young people get to 16 and 17 and become aware of OnlyFans, you can see that's a certain trajectory that they're set up here. So the take-home messages are we begin to resolve perhaps some of the stuff around OnlyFans by being able to have meaningful conversations with children and young people at the right stages around pornography in school settings. That's what young people are telling us. And also we need to be clear that the teeth that are in the online safety bill in relation to age assurance will absolutely work in this space. Mm-hmm. The stuff around AI, I don't really want to go to, apart from just the police colleagues could maybe back up. But there is some work in that area being done. I'm thinking particularly of, there's a web crawler called Project Arachnid that Canada has developed that's been running for several years, doing precisely what you're describing.
Interesting. Thank you. Any others? I know it's very specific.
But legislation, I don't necessarily think it would need legislation. I think any private company could use and deploy such AI as it saw fit for the greater good if it chose to do so. But I don't think that would require legislation, I don't think.
if I might come in on that, we are doing some more work to understand AI, the risks it poses, as well as the opportunities which may become available to us. It is not the only, I wouldn't say future tech because it's here now, but it's not the only piece of technology that we are looking into. There's also the metaverse, the use of haptic suits, which give a much more visceral experience of being in an online space and present particular threats for CSA. We are looking at a range of technologies and how they may affect and manifest in the CSA space. Mm-hmm. It comes back to the importance of safety by design, which was mentioned right at the beginning of the session, and the importance of companies having the responsibility to design spaces which are safe for children.
That's really interesting. In fact, I guess by its very nature, AI is designed to create unnatural, fancy environments in the real world which do not hitherto exist. That could definitely be problematic in some circumstances. So, anyone else before I...
come in the latter point, Jamie, because obviously from a Barnardo's perspective, that's in terms of the increase in pornography, that's something that we're seeing right across our services. And just as Stuart's mentioned, it's very young people. You know, we've had 11, 12, 13-year-olds, and we are extremely concerned in terms of the impact on mental health, but also in terms of their understanding of what is and what constitutes a healthy and respectful relationship. But also on your point in terms of OnlyFans, and it's interesting how OnlyFans is getting this kind of attention, but we kind of came across advertising websites like Lecanto, for instance, where children were being encouraged to advertise on site as well, and coupled with the cost of living crisis and the impact in terms of fuel poverty and food poverty, we have had young people who have actively gone on those sites in an attempt to make money. And they've been very vocal about that, and it's quite difficult because I think that's one of the kind of challenges that we are finding in terms of online, the kind of reach to young people is so significant in terms of providing them with opportunities that we can't provide them with in terms of income, and that's something that we need to think about in terms of, and particularly in terms of how we then, I suppose, try and respond to those young people in terms of harmful behaviours and not criminalising those young people. And I know colleagues in police in particular are working really hard not to criminalise, but I think it's also against a backdrop of media who do want to criminalise children for some of those behaviours as well. So it's quite tough.
It's really fascinating. We could probably have an all-day symposium on that subject alone. I just had, if permitted, one final question, and I feel a bit like an audience member on question time with this one, but what does the panel believe would be an appropriate level of sentencing for someone who is charged and prosecuted for possessing indecent images of children? Start with the police, I'm afraid.
It's not a matter for policing. Wendy and I had a discussion about sentencing yesterday, and arguably an increased vexedness in England and Wales about it from a policing perspective. But of course, privately, individual officers might have a view on what's an appropriate sentence. But in the main, do we see lesser sentences in Scotland in terms of years in jail across the board of a range of offences in Scotland in contrast to England and Wales? Yes, we do. Is there a reason for that? Well, there must be. But no, the background of any individual perpetrator is wide and varied and needs to be taken into account. And obviously other bodies will introduce guidance for sentencing that's not...
Very, very diplomatic of you. The reason I ask is that the last time a survey was done on this, and it was pre-COVID, I don't know if it's been updated since, but public perceptions of sentencing showed that 77% of the public believe someone should receive a custodial sentence for a crime of that nature. Very few believe that something such as a community payback order or even some form of educational, you know, mandatory statutory treatment or education would be an appropriate sentence. So I'm not putting forward a view, I'm simply asking for your opinion. I appreciate it's difficult for policing to comment on what are independent guidelines, I suppose, by the Sentencing Council, but I'm sure others have a view. Stuart, you must have a view on this.
Yeah, I don't really want to present a view, particularly because you're talking about an incredibly wide range of different things.
Yeah,
I mean,
of course,
at one end of the spectrum, where you're a 14-year-old who sends some sexual images of themselves to a number of peers who haven't asked for those images, it's an offence. It probably needs to be dealt with as a legal matter as well as a child protection matter, through to, you know, an adult who's been involved with live streaming or indeed has been involved with first generation images, meaning that he sexually abused a child, filmed it and put that on online. Mm-hmm. You know, we can't have one sentencing option for all those different situations. You can have guidelines. And I know the research that you're talking about, Jamie, because some of that's described really well in the Sentencing Council literature review on indecent images of children that came out last year. And there's a big section on public views in all of that. I think these are questions for society more general rather than third sector organisations such as us. But one thing I would add, and I'm saying this partly in my work as a kind of social worker in this field, but also I'm the chair of NOTA, the National Organisation for the Treatment of Abuse, which is the main membership body for those who work with sex offenders in the UK. We have 1,300 members. And what that would suggest, the research would suggest that giving custodial sentences for individuals who may be at relatively low risk of reoffending will probably make things worse for them and actually may make them more dangerous. The reason being that if you give somebody a short sentence in prison, you're not giving enough opportunity or time for them to do any direct work in relation to their offending behaviour, but when they come out, they're likely to be homeless, they're likely to have lost their job, and they're likely to have lost the social anchoring that they had in their community. And all those kind of things are the kind of things that then can tip people through stress into going back into offending behaviour. So although there's a simplistic answer about, well, it takes people out of society who have committed what we need to recognise as really serious offences, we also need to have a kind of pragmatic and grown-up kind of conversation about actually what are the kind of things that we need to do here to make sure that children are better protected in Scotland.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Martin, final words.
A small point to pick up on, and Daljeet, I'm sorry to contradict you slightly about, it's just to let the committee understand how we operate currently, which, so the taking of the televisions and all the devices out of the house will have happened in the past, will happen in the future, but in the main, and one of the significant practice improvements that we've made post-HMIS thematic inspection in 2020 is the uplift and resourcing of our digital forensic teams. So their triage teams come with us, so the knock with the police officers, part of that group, unfortunately, of many people that go through the door include digital forensic staff who triage the devices on site. So in the main, in most occasions now, every turn or enforcement activity is accompanied by such officers who will, you might have 10 devices in a house, just for argument's sake, and two come away for if they're positive and the rest are left in situ. So one of the benefits is it lessens to some degree the impact that Daljeet is describing, that, as I say, will have happened in the past and will in the future. But in the main, we only take the devices that prove positive on triage for a whole host of reasons, but that's one of the benefits that falls from that.
Thanks very much for that. That's a very helpful clarification. So I'm going to draw this session to a close. It's been fascinating, a lot for us to think about in terms of the work that is clearly going on, that is really welcome to hear about, the commitment in and around this issue, but also the challenges and the work required going forward. So I'd just like to thank you all for your time today, and we'll just suspend the meeting very briefly to allow our panel members to leave. Thanks very much. Thank you. Thank you very much, members. So our next item of business is consideration of correspondence that we have received from the Scottish Government and Rape Crisis Scotland on access to court transcripts for survivors of rape and sexual offences. And I refer members to paper 4. And I would like to begin by placing on record the committee's thanks to one of the survivors that we met informally in November 2021 for her bravery in telling us about her experience of the criminal justice system and for raising the important issue of a lack of access to court transcripts for survivors of rape and sexual offences and how this can impact on recovery. And I very much welcome the commitment made by the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs in her letter to the committee and by the First Minister last week to consider a pilot to support access to transcripts for complainers in sexual offences cases. So I'd just like to open up to members to ask for any views that you might have on the correspondence that we've received. Jamie?
Thank you. Can I thank Rape Crisis Scotland for their correspondence? I may perhaps take a contrary view to the convener. Unfortunately, I don't welcome the letter. I welcome the letter itself, but not its content, I'm afraid. This is an issue which we as a committee have been raising for a very long time, since the instigation of this particular committee. I'm sure it's not the first time this issue has been raised in Parliament. The second to last paragraph of the letter from the Cabinet Secretary, whilst in its tone is helpful and positive, I don't doubt that, and I don't doubt the intentions of the Cabinet Secretary, but in terms of detail, it's lacking considerably. The Cabinet Secretary says that she's committed to exploring a pilot to support access to transcripts for complainers in sexual offences cases initially. However, it is at very early stages, and initial discussions with the SETS are taking place. I thought those discussions had taken place. Given that this issue has been raised repeatedly by this committee and other stakeholders on numerous occasions over a prolonged period of time, I do not understand why this discussion is still either yet to happen or is in very early stages. The letter also sort of infers that the forthcoming Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill, which is coming to Parliament, may provide some form of platform for providing a solution to this in the long term. I mean, personally, I don't believe you need primary legislation to resolve this matter. It just needs a bit of will and a bit of way. We've talked in numerous committee meetings about we understand the financial considerations that are involved in improving the situation. But as we then hear straight from those directly affected by this in great volume, when you read the survey responses that were sent to us by Rape Crisis Scotland, I think we should put on record our thanks to the victims who've given permission for that to be used. There's two very common themes coming through. One is that very few victims feel like they remember the day in court due to the trauma involved, and they believe that accessing transcripts would form a part of the closure, perhaps, or perhaps they are seeking justice in other ways through civil cases and so on. Many had a difficult experience in the court. Many actually believed that they were not treated particularly well, or indeed that there were miscarriages of justice in some extreme cases. And I think the language that they've used, we should take note of, and I think this should give us more impetus to push the government on this. The comments made include things like this: lack of access to my transcript has hindered my ability to complete a complaint against a case. It was cost prohibitive. I heard there was no point. It's allowed me not to achieve closure. Part of me is still seeking justice, and so on and so forth. In fact, one went on to say, I had no idea I was even allowed to have access to them. So it's a real shocking spectrum of opinions on this. And I suspect this is just a small number of those who can try to access these transcripts. I just feel like the letter just says you know, we're having a conversation with the courts. It's very early stages and we'll get back to you. That's what we heard last time. We had correspondence from a previous cabinet secretary. It's what we heard from the previous cabinet secretary before that. And the content of the letter is always positive and you know, don't worry, we're looking at this issue, but we never, ever see any detail of it. And it pains me to say that, I'm afraid, because I do believe that the new cabinet secretary of justice will take this issue very seriously and will try and make progress on it. But we're not seeing progress. We just see one-page letters promising action that we never see action on. And I think people out there want some concrete detail about how this either pilot will go ahead, what it will look like, and how it will be communicated to people, stakeholders and victims. So I'd like to see more done faster.
Okay, put quite simply. Okay, thank you, Jamie. Rona, I think you want to come in.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, I mean, I agree with Jamie about, you know, the rape crisis communication, and I don't think there's an issue about anybody not thinking that court transcripts should be available. I don't take such a gloomy view of the letter, I have to be honest. I think the paragraph where the Cabinet Secretary says, look forward to working with the committee, and also as we progress the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill, I think Jamie was perhaps conflating the two. She's saying, yes, she's looking forward to working with the committee on the issue of court transcripts, but also, you know, because this is a huge bill that's coming down the line, she's just mentioned that. I'm not sure that the two could be conflated. And also, she's in a couple of paragraphs, I mean, she's absolutely stated her commitment to doing this. I do think that's an issue that we could follow up with. You know, can we get a timescale, you know, so that we're clearer on that? But I think on the whole, it's a very, you know, it's just sort of stating what we had thought was happening. And I know it's gone on for a long time. So I think for me, it would be the issue of, well, when is the pilot starting? And more detail on that would be fine. But I don't think it's as gloomy as Jamie's making out.
Okay, thank you very much. Anyone else want to come in at all? No. Okay, thanks very much, Rona and Jamie. I've certainly noted your comments about timescales. I probably wouldn't disagree on that. It does seem to be that we've been looking at this for quite some time. What I would just flag, if it's helpful for members, is last week the First Minister in the Conveners Group meeting, in response to a question that I asked about progress in terms of access to court transcripts, and I'll just read out his response, and I quote, the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs was planning to write to the committee this week expressing the government's commitment to supporting a pilot to support access to court transcripts and initially focused on complainers in sexual offence cases. So it is an issue that I am well aware of, given my previous role as a Cabinet Secretary for Justice, and we will absolutely commit to a pilot focused initially on complainers in sexual offence cases. So I'm certainly happy to hear that. I think that that's where we would want to be. I absolutely take the point about timescales, and if members would wish, I'm happy to write to the government, just seeking perhaps a little bit more clarity in and around timescales. I would also suggest, if members are in agreement, that we send a copy of the Cabinet Secretary's letter to Rape Crisis Scotland for their information, and Scottish Women's Aid and Victims Support Scotland, who have all been interested and active in this issue, for their information. So are members agreed with that proposal? Jamie?
Thank you very much. And that update from the First Minister is very helpful. It's perhaps even goes a step further than the letter we have in terms of language. I think rather than, as well as timescales, I think some, even just a broad sketch of the potential of what the pilot might entail, just so I think we can manage expectations among stakeholders. I think if there's a large cohort of people who may feel that that's something that would be advantage to them, to later discover that the pilot is limited in nature, I think it would be disappointing for them. So I think just to make sure that we're, you know, heading in the right direction to make it as broad and comprehensive as possible.
Yeah, I'm happy. I think it's appropriate that we maybe ask for or keep track of progress and ask perhaps to be updated as and when there are developments. Okay, thank you very much indeed. So that concludes our business in public for this morning, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.